Hey, what's up guys? This is Christian Brindle with Six Figure Medicare Agent. Hope this video finds you doing well. And we're back with another video. Today, guys, we're gonna talk to you about how insurance sales works, how you get paid, how you make money, what you have to do. If for any of you that might be watching this that have no idea and you wanna maybe potentially get into insurance sales, we're gonna kinda go over the entire process and kinda go over everything you need to know. Before we get into that though, I gotta talk to you guys about this video's sponsor, my favorite telemarketing lead company, and that of course is Lead Heroes. Guys, if you're selling senior insurance, like final expense, Medicare supplements, Lead Heroes has got you covered. They got something for everybody. They specialize in telemarketing leads, where one of their trained and expert callers is actually making calls on your behalf for you and finding you prospects for your pipeline and for your funnels. Just because you guys watch this video, they're going to give you 10% off any order you make on their website. A link to their website can be found down in the description of this video, as well as a coupon code right next to it that gives you 10% off on checkout. So go ahead and check them out. All right, guys, so let's talk about how does insurance sales really work, right? So let's kind of go through exactly how you get paid, what do you have to do, what is the criteria, and the whole nine yards. So the first thing you have to do, guys, is you have to get your state insurance license. So depending on the state that you live, that's going to be considered in the insurance world as your resident state, right? So you, for your resident state, you are going to have to take a test. You're going to have to pay a fee to take this test in order to obtain your state insurance license. So that's going to be the first step. Now, I'm going to kind of factor these two things, these two topics together into one little segment here. So you have to pick a line of insurance. What I mean by a line of insurance is you have to decide if you want a health insurance license, a life insurance license. Actually, it's most common that people get the health insurance license and the life insurance license together in the same test, and you can do that with that particular lines of licenses. You can get a securities license to be able to work with lots of different financial services products, investment products, if you will. You can get just a life insurance license. You can get a property and casualty license, which gives you the ability to sell homeowners insurance, car insurance, things like that, renter's insurance, pet insurance, for those of you who don't know, and so on and so forth. And so you have to take your test and get your license. Now, typically with most states, the way that this test is actually going to take place is you're going to have to pay a fee for this said test. And then you're going to have to take a test that's going to be a multitude of questions. A lot of times you're going to have to take this test in a secure location where you're being monitored so they know that you're not cheating. So you really do have to study to be able to actually take these tests. Now, there's a lot of different practice tests that you can take online. It's going to kind of depend on your state and kind of what the criteria is going to entail. Every state is a little bit different. But practice tests are involved. There's actually different education companies that I've seen all across the country that you can actually go to a class of theirs, and sometimes it's a 1 or 2 day class, and they'll kind of go through a textbook that you have to go through that you can study to kind of learn what you need to know. One thing I can tell you about the state insurance licensing exam is 90% of what you need to know to pass the test doesn't matter, and you'll never have to use it again, ever. It's just like real school, right? In real life, when you go to high school, it's a bunch of gobbledygook that doesn't matter and it's worthless. It's a waste of time. And I'm sorry if I offend anybody by saying that. It's just the truth, right? Because unless you're teaching algebra, or unless you're working with it in some kind of profession, I guess on a day-to-day basis, you're never gonna use algebra again. Same goes for the state insurance licensing exam. This is the kind of the way it goes. They're gonna teach you things that you're never gonna have to worry about or never gonna have to know about. And that's just part of the game, you know, that's just part of the way that it is, but that's okay. You just got to go through it to be able to get the test and learn the information to be able to get the test, and then the real work can begin. So the other thing to keep in mind when it comes to getting your license is they're going to check your background, your credit score. They will not just hand an insurance license to anybody. So depending on your background, if you have maybe a checkered past and a difficult background, they might not approve you to be able to give you or grant you an insurance license, even if you pass the test. They might not even let you take the test. Why is this? Well, people ask me that all the time. I would say the main reason and the best answer I can give you is when you are working as an insurance agent, right, when you have an insurance license and you're working with people, you are taking a lot of responsibility into your hands. They're giving you their trust. They're giving you their private information, like social security numbers, right? Home addresses, just private information that would be HIPAA protected. HIPAA means HIPAA has to deal with privacy laws. And typically insurance departments don't want anything but the highest or high enough quality of people that are going to be placed in those privileged positions. And so if you have a checkered past, if you have too many bad things or lumps on your record, you might not be approved to get an insurance license. So just keep that in mind if you're watching this video. Like if you just got out of prison, might not happen for you. It just might not, potentially, right? So this is what you need to understand and kind of the way and the criteria that they're really going to be looking for. Once you get your license, let's say we fast forward, you've done your studying, you did a good job, you jumped through the hoops, you did your fingerprints, because a lot of times you have to do fingerprints in order to get your background check and get your actual license. And you come out the other side and you get your insurance license. The next thing you're going to have to do is, depending on the line of insurance, like I said, that you're going to be involved in, most lines of insurance are going to have what's known as uplines. The insurance industry is very, very multi-level marketing-ish. It has a lot of facets of multi-level marketing implemented into it. So there's typically going to be uplines. There, in a lot of cases, you're not going to be able to contract direct to an insurance company and just be completely direct to the insurance company. Some insurance companies you can, and some different kinds of lines of insurance you can. But for the most part, you typically have to contract under a larger organization and a larger industry to where they're going to make a little bit of a cut that we call override when you make a sale. It typically is not going to come from your sales in most cases. In some lines of insurance it can, like life insurance is going to be a little bit of that, right? It's like the more of an override they get, the less commission that you get, right? In a lot of cases, depending on how high of a contract level that they might have and et cetera, but I'm getting into the weeds here a little bit. But you typically are going to have to contract under an upline. The word upline is usually has a lot of connotation with it for multi-level marketing, but also in the insurance industry. So your upline is essentially the organization that you contract under. So let's say the insurance company is here, your upline is here, and you are here, right? So they're in between you and the insurance company. Now, uplines can be good and bad, and there's just not enough time in this video to really jump into everything you need to know when it comes to uplines, but the main thing you gotta understand is an upline, if you pick the right one, can be your best friend. They can help you with your business. They can provide you resources. They can provide you, you know, training and guidance and mentorship that can really cut your learning curve and allow you to be much more successful. Because the main thing to keep in mind with insurance sales, my friends, is there is always going to be a lot of a learning curve. There's a lot of information that you need to know. There's so much that you need to know. And having an upline is going to help you out dramatically. Now, this is if you're going to be contracted as an independent agent and be self-employed. There's such a thing as what's known as a captive agent, or somebody that actually is an employed agent, where you might go work in a call center or you work for an agency and they have you on the payroll. At that point, the company you work for is technically, I guess, your upline, but it's not so much as it's not so much of a difficulty in terms of knowing who to contract with. You contract with your employer at that point. So the other thing to keep in mind is commissions. So how do you make money as an insurance agent? Well, insurance sales is a contact sport. So when you meet with somebody, or let's say you get you're out talking to somebody and you're able to find a need, whatever it is you might be selling, let's say it's property and casualty, and let's say you're selling car insurance, well maybe they're paying too much for their car insurance. You're able to get them a similar policy for a fraction of the price. Well, they buy it through you, right? All ends well. You're going to typically make a percentage. And different lines of insurance are going to be different. I'm not a P&C agent. I actually sell Medicare health insurance. So I've done many videos about how that works specifically. But a lot of times you're going to make a percentage, or depending on the line of insurance, it might be a set commission rate of what you're going to make. And then essentially, depending on the type of insurance, you might get advanced commission for the rest of that year. You might get advanced commission for 9 months at a time, 12 months at a time. And what I mean by 9 months and 12 months is it's 9 months of the premium that that person might be paying. Or 12 months of the premium that that person might have be paying. Now, that's a good thing because it gets you a lot of money in your pocket very quickly as an agent, and you can make a lot of money very quickly. it can be tricky, and you do need to know that if the person cancels before that advance is run out, then you're going to have to pay it back to the insurance company. So that's what we call in the industry a chargeback. And other types of insurance are just going to pay you 1 month at a time. So every month when your client pays their premium, you will get a little bit of that, like a little tiny percentage of that every month, and it accumulates. The insurance business is definitely built on the back of residual and renewal income. Now, certain lines of insurance are going to pay more of a residual income facet than others, right? So like health insurance, Obamacare insurance, under 65 health insurance, Medicare, they're going to pay much more on the residual side than maybe like a life insurance will. Life insurance still pays some kind of residual income, but they're more based on the big commission up front, and then they're going to pay you much less in year 2, 3, 4, or 5 of the policy. So the insurance business is about relationships, right? The insurance business is all about relationships. It's about finding a need for a client or a prospect, helping them with that need, and then building that relationship and making sure you're taking care of them over a long period of time. The goal with an insurance customer is you want to keep them on your books as long as possible and keep them happy and wanting to work with you as long as possible. Because the longer that takes place, the longer you're going to be able to reap the benefits of being able to work with them, right? And it should be a mutually beneficial relationship. It should be that you're benefiting them with your service and your help and your guidance just as much as you're getting in terms of the compensation. It should be a win-win for both you and the customer. Anytime that it's not, there's a problem going on for whatever reason. The other thing you have to keep in mind when it comes to insurance, selling insurance, is once you get your license, you have to keep your license up. You have to keep it active. So there's such a thing as called CE. CE stands for continuing education. So typically you have to sit in classes, go through courses for a certain amount of hours every couple of years, depending on what type of line of insurance you actually have. And you're going to have to do that and pay a couple fees to renew your license every so often. It's not to say that it's a lifetime achievement award. They want to make sure that you're kept up with recent changes. And that's what continuing education is all about. You also have to have what's known as E&O insurance. E&O stands for errors and omissions insurance, just in case you mess up, make a mistake on somebody's policy, and maybe somebody tries to sue you or place a lawsuit. The errors and omissions insurance is going to require, that is going to pay for that for you and kind of cover you, essentially. The main thing with errors and omissions insurance is most insurance companies, if not all, are going to require that you have it. A lot of times it's $300, maybe $400 a year. Just kind of depends on kind of the coverage that you're going to need. But anyway, guys, this is a 10,000 foot view of how does it work to sell insurance and be an insurance agent and be in the insurance industry as an independent agent. If you have any additional questions that maybe we didn't touch on in this, I know that's a lot of information and this is really a 10,000 foot view. Feel free to drop them in the comment section so we can answer them for you. Drop a like on this video so more people like you can find it. It helps with the YouTube algorithm dramatically, so it would really mean a lot to me if you drop a like on this video. I would really appreciate it. We need it. Make sure to hit the subscribe button. If you're not subscribed already, hit the notification bell so you're notified when we upload. And appreciate you taking the time to watch this video. I hope it was helpful. And here's to your success and your abundance. Thanks, guys.